they lose their leaves in the dry season. Tropical forests are not all thick jungles. A few of them even have cacti. Some of Costa Rica's greatest assets are its diverse forests and natural landscapes.
Ich sehe dann nicht nur einen Berg, sondern auch einen Vulkan. Klingt gefährlich.
Costa Rica got its first real railroads up and running about 100 years ago. Their primary purpose was to move coffee harvested in the central basin to the Caribbean coast.
They built railroads here 100 years ago? That's impressive.
It was even more difficult than you would imagine. Later, they started using the railroads for shipping bananas too. There still might be some branch lines around here.
Ja, werden wir vielleicht sehen.
Aldea de los Despiertos means Village of the Awake.
Weird name.
The area is littered with coffee fields, and there is a factory nearby. The villagers are fans of coffee. So?
Na super.
Yeah, they don't get much sleep, huh? They've got a sense of humor, all right.
I cannot believe they would take over a place like this and use it as a prison. It is unforgivable for both the CIA and the thugs they employ. All the villagers wanted was to live in peace. What gives the CIA the right to crush them like that?
They don't care about anyone's rights but their own. It's just the way some people are.
You really think so?
Don't worry. It just gives me the right to teach them a lesson.
Ja. Kann man sich auch schönreden, Leute eine Lektion zu erteilen, ne? Weil sie sich so benehmen. Aber okay. So, dann mal hier Amanda.
Amanda, how do I get to the prison camp?
First, head up the narrow mountain path. The path will gradually open up and you'll come to a fork in the road. Watch yourself up there. You'll be lower than the surrounding terrain. So if you head down the middle, you'll make for an easy target.
Yeah, thanks for the heads up.
Take the leftward path to reach the prison camp.
Ja, das ist erstmal der Weg dahin.
What can you tell me about the prison camp?
Well, it used to be a village until they took control of it. It's a maze of paths, so watch out for soldiers on patrol.
I'll be sure not to stop and say hi.
Use the paths carefully, and you should be able to stay out of view.
Where are they holding Chico?
One of the houses, most likely. You can peek through the doors. Just press the action button when the icon appears. You could also listen to any sounds inside for clues.
Good idea.
Guards will still be on the move while you're looking inside. Make sure you don't get caught. And Snake.
I know. I'll bring him back.
Thank you. I know I can count on you.
Ja. Wenn man nicht auf irgendjemanden zählen kann, dann auf Snake. Oder? So. Über den Einsatz. Dateibibliothek. Ah, da ist was Neues. Der große Führer. Hm. Ah ja, jetzt erfahren wir hier noch ein paar Hintergründe.
So I hear Amanda mistook you for Che Guevara, Snake. That's not too bad, huh?
Yeah, right. I'm not even worthy of polishing his boots.
Don't be so modest. From where I'm standing, your men see you as a great man.
As great as the century's most complete human being.
That's Sartre, right? Well, there's hardly been a more iconic figure of his times than Che.
Oh, he was more than that. He was a true revolutionary. And a great warrior.
I'm with you there. Can you believe that when he first went to Cuba with Fidel, they had only 12 guys with them?
But they rallied. They brought in new recruits, won the support of the peasants, expanded their organization.
And in the end, they overthrew the Batista regime.
People flocked to them because they were honest. They won because they were strong. Those are the qualities that make men great.
You know, we're kind of in the same boat they were back then. Here we are, a handful of mercenaries taking on an army backed by the United States.
Yeah, we've got a long way to go.
But we've got to keep on going. It's not just about winning in battle. You need to think about recruiting people and growing this operation.
Got it.
Ja, in dem Sinne sind wir Che Guevara wirklich sehr ähnlich.
Boss, did you ever read Che Guevara's book, Guerrilla Warfare?
Aye. I can't remember if I got to that one or not.
You should have. That's why I lent it to you. A lot of the guerrilla tactics it covers apply to sneaking missions, too. Che was one of the first people to articulate the theory of guerrilla warfare. T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, was another one. And Mao Zedong and his On Protracted War. Theory aside, Nicaragua's General Sandino was one of the first to put guerrilla tactics into practice. Which explains why the Sandinistas named themselves after him.
If you think about it, guerrilla warfare itself has been around since ancient times. There's only so many ways a small group can upset a large army.
There was a samurai in Japan who excelled in guerrilla warfare.
No kidding.
Tsunoki Masashige. He was a warrior who lived in the medieval era. He used unconventional tactics to help overthrow the Kamakura shogunate.
Like what?
Trojan horse-style maneuvers and decoys to confuse the enemy. The best one was when the enemy was climbing the castle walls. He dumped boiling water and human excrement on them.
Huh, sounds great. Let's put it in the MSF playbook.
You're not serious, are you, boss?
Why not? We've got plenty of crap to unload.
Yeah. I'll think about it.
Ja, klingt nach einer guten Taktik, die eigene Basis zu verteidigen. Jay besucht Hiroshima. Ah ja.
The year the Cuban Revolution was won, Che visited Japan as a member of an economic delegation. While he was there, he visited Hiroshima.
Hiroshima.
Since he was there to discuss economic issues, Hiroshima wasn't part of the original itinerary. Some said the Ministry of Foreign Affairs didn't want to let him go, but he went anyway. He snuck out of his hotel and took an overnight train.
Huh. Traveling guerrilla style. Sounds like Che, all right.
He visited the Peace Memorial Museum and the Atomic Bomb Survivors Hospital. Apparently, it gave him quite a shock. As a doctor, it must have been painful for him to see how the victims suffered.
Nukes destroy everything.
He was quoted as saying, "They put you through this, and still you do whatever America says." Those words really hit me hard, especially when I think of my mom. He said something else, too. Let us all love Hiroshima and its people.
I can believe it. Che never managed to numb himself to other people's pain. That's why people loved him. And why he died.
Oh ja, das werden wir wahrscheinlich gleich in einer der nächsten Tapes erfahren. Ist ja auch eine sehr bekannte Geschichte, aber gut.
That bandana you're always wearing, that thing's a real antique. Ever think about getting a new one?
This one's fine.
Come on, we can't have our boss wearing a raggedy old thing like that.
It was a gift, okay? Wouldn't be right to get rid of it.
It was. Okay, then. Speaking of which, Che supposedly had a black scarf he used to take everywhere with him.
A scarf?
One of his comrades gave it to him when he broke his arm in battle. Che used that silk scarf as a sling. And the comrade who gave it to him became his second wife.
Alida, right?
Even after his arm healed up, he never went anywhere without that scarf. What about you? You get that bandana from someone special?
No, nothing like that. It's important to me, that's all.
Ja, wieder so ein recht interessanter Vergleich, ne, was Merkmale angeht. So, typenfeindlicher Soldaten. CIA-Söldner, okay.
Amanda and her crew tell me they've managed to identify several different categories of mercenaries employed by the CIA.
Give me a rundown. Sounds like info I could use.
No problem. I'll go through them in order.
Na gut, schauen wir uns mal ein paar Gegnertypen an, ist ja auch eine coole Sache.
The type of enemy you'll be seeing most is the type that patrols and guards a specific operational area. For the sake of convenience, Amanda's crew calls the outdoor ones patrolmen and the indoor ones guards. They might look like they're just out for a stroll, but don't be fooled. They're sharper than they look. All of their senses are finely honed. Normally, they'll patrol along fixed routes, but when the alert level is raised, they'll assume a more efficient alert posture and focus on defending specific points. That's bad for you. Obviously, they can hold their own in combat. And with body armor, it'll be even harder to take them down. If they're wearing a bulletproof helmet, you can forget about one-shot kills. Just a heads up. You'll need to be smart about using camo and pick your routes. The most important thing is to avoid detection.
Ja, da fällt uns bestimmt noch was ein. Und mit der Betäubungspistole gibt's noch einen anderen Schwachpunkt, wenn die Helme tragen.
When the enemy spots you and goes on alert, they may call in a backup strike team. These assault teams are heavily armed, well-trained, and highly dangerous. Amanda's crew calls them commandos. Unlike the patrolmen, these guys will actively, relentlessly track and hunt you down like hounds.
Hounds to hunt a former foxhound. Bring it on.
They won't give up easily, even if they lose sight of you. They'll clear out any likely hiding places they come across. So don't get too comfy in one spot, or you might get caught again. Keep your eyes fixed on them and what they're doing. Also, be aware the commando gear includes body armor, so don't think you can deal with them by going in guns blazing.
All I've got to do is find an exposed weak point, and...
Exactly.
Ja, das ist doch unsere Spezialität, oder?
There are areas out there where enemy soldiers are deployed in multiple layers for extra coverage. More than a few of those will be attacking you from a distance, rooftops and far-off vantage points. Try not to get too distracted by nearby enemies, because you could be leaving yourself wide open to longer-range attacks.
I'll be careful.
Das ist ein Wort von ihm, ne? Soldatenlevel.
We know there are variations in the kinds of gear patrolmen and commandos wear, especially the body armor. Our scouts report that an enemy's defense and firing accuracy are directly proportional to how heavy their gear is.
Those must be the guys with the highest combat skills. They can fight in heavier gear without their performance suffering.
Supposedly, it's pretty easy to tell the difference in gear just by looking. So remember, use extra caution when dealing with enemies wearing heavy gear.
Das sowieso, aber im besten Fall lassen wir es gar nicht dazu kommen, dass die auftauchen, oder?
Enemies will try to fight you from different distances, based on the weapon they've got equipped. When you meet an enemy, get a good look at what they're carrying. It can make or break your chances in battle.
Das, ja, ist ziemliche Grundlage.
Enemies carrying handguns and shotguns will try and get in close. That makes them dangerous, but at the same time, easier to hit. Keep your wits about you, and you can turn a threat into an opportunity.
Turning a threat into an opportunity. Das ist ein guter Ratschlag.
Enemies carrying assault rifles and machine guns will usually fire at you from farther away. Use whatever cover you can find, then return fire with a few well-placed shots of your own.
Ich nehme das wieder zurück mit seinen guten
Sprüchen. Don't expect enemies carrying sniper rifles or rocket launchers to get up close and personal. They'll be constantly moving from place to place, looking for an opening to snipe at you. Tricky bastards. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. Go with the sniper rifle. Make sure you stay out of their line of sight, and when they expose themselves, take them down.
Machen wir. Irgendwann werden wir wohl noch auf Scharfschützen treffen. Aber okay, so, damit haben wir alles von Miller. Bei Pass gibt's nichts Neues, aber Amanda haben wir jetzt noch gar nichts von ihr gehört.
Since it was founded, my country has not once been able to choose its own path. First Spain, then America. Over 100 years of this.
I know.
In the 19th century, an American mercenary named William Walker seized power in Nicaragua.
I'd heard he exploited rivalries between the political parties.
Even after we expelled him, the Americans sent in their Marines under the pretext of quelling political unrest.
And the real reason?
To intimidate the government and thwart the construction of the Nicaragua Canal.
William Walker, the Nicaragua Canal.
I thought the U.S. already has the rights to build a canal in Nicaragua.
They never intended to build a canal there. They'd already started digging in Panama. A canal in Nicaragua would break up the Panama Canal's monopoly. Reason enough for America to stick its nose into our affairs.
They snagged the rights so nobody else could build there.
It was General Sandino who finally stood up to Los Yankees.
Los Yankees. Yankees, huh?
General Sandino waged a guerrilla war against the Marines, at last driving them out. He was a true hero. And to us Sandinistas, like a father. But when they pulled out, the Americans left us something to remember them by.
The National Guard.
Yes, La Guardia. In name, a peacekeeping force. But in reality, Commander Somoza's personal army, answering to no one else. Unable to stay silent, General Sandino went to protest and was assassinated by Somoza as he made his way home. It was then that Somoza and Los Sapos began to eat our country alive from the inside.
Ermordet auf dem Heimweg.
It has been 40 years since the Somoza family became the rulers of Nicaragua. with La Guardia at their command. No one can challenge them.
You came here on the run from the National Guard, right?
Si. They took everything. Our land, our homes, our jobs.
Now belong to Somoza.
Si. The law, too. He's even got the judges in his pocket. You defy him, you face death. Everyone bows at scrapes before La Guardia. Even then you might get a beating if they are in a bad mood.
And you're trying to change things.
That's not all. These Somozas have used their power to line their pockets. They confiscate people's land and hand it to members of the Somoza family. By now, close to half the farmland in Nicaragua is theirs. We were powerless until... You remember the earthquake 2 years ago?
Yeah. I heard the capital was hit pretty hard.
We lost Managua, our capital city. People sent aid from all around the world. Tears of sorrow turned to tears of joy. Yet almost all of it was embezzled by the Somozas. They sold out those who'd lost everything for money. They feasted on our country's suffering. Public resentment is at the boiling point. The Somozas' days are numbered. We will see to it.
Erdbeben als ein Wendepunkt. Hm?
The first Somoza was originally no more than the commander of La Guardia. Ordinarily, a man of his station could never hope to become president. But the president at the time had no power to back him. The only one with the strength to oppose him was General Sandino. No, better to say the general was the only one who dared oppose him. There was nothing special about him. Above all, it takes a strong will to see justice done. That is what he taught us.
It's also what motivated Somoza to have him killed.
Yes, the rest was easy. He got rid of the president, taking office in a sham election. And once he had the power, he never gave it up.
Talk about heavy-handed.
He had the Americans backing him, that's why. They didn't want to hand over power to a rebellious general.
Even so, it's hard to believe Washington would give its blessing to a guy like that.
The American president at the time put it this way. Somoza may be a son of a bitch, but he's our son of a bitch. In other words, better a dog or los sapos than an anti-US regime.